audible?
Yes. Yes.
I am.
Very much.
Is everyone awake?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We just had tea.
Okay. So I'm going to present session on good UX is equals to accessible UI design. And I'm Nikita Aswani and Asmita Varas with me. So we are going to do a present session on this. So title is quite like easy to understand, that if we want our website to be easily understandable by users, if we want good user experience, that will give us good accessibility. Or we can say these both things are directly proportional. If we have good accessibility on our website, that means our website is easily, it has good user experience. So what we are going to cover in this slide is, what is accessibility? Why is accessibility? Why we should do accessibility? Web content accessibility guidelines levels, and then there are few myths and misunderstandings regarding accessibility. So we are going to discuss that, and after that we'll discuss how in a web development life cycle accessibility plays its role, and then few practices that we should follow around accessibility or around web development. Accessibility tools, a few tips and tricks, how accessibility and SEO are interconnected in some way, and at the end we'll discuss accessibility features that Drupal has started to provide us. So let's jump into what is accessibility. Accessibility has two things. One, how user is going to perceive our website. Second, how we are making our website easy to be perceivable by user. It has two. So as a developer, I am just developing a website, and as a user, he is going to like consume my application. So why accessibility is important is, there are two things. One is like for business purpose also, it is good. We'll get more and more users, we'll cover a big spectrum of users that are going to consume our application. The second thing is, being a developer, whatever we are doing it for the users. So we should think about users before even thinking about our application or our efforts. Myth about accessibility. So I think all of us are developers here and testers. Yeah? Is everyone new to web development here? So the first is, accessibility helps disabled people access the website. How many of you agree with this line? So why I said that this is a myth is, it doesn't only help disabled people, it helps people who are capable enough to access everything on the website, but there are other few things that are interrupting them to access our content. So whenever we talk about web accessibility, the very common thing that comes in our mind is blind people, which is like very common example, I understand. But there are a few other disabilities, a few other things that interrupts. For example, some people have color blindness, some people have low vision, some people, maybe someone met an accident and he can't like completely use his organs, but it's a temporary disability. So blind people or disabled people are not the only one. Let's say I'm using a Bluetooth mouse and suddenly it stopped working. So I should be able to access whatever I'm accessing through keyboard also. Being developers also, most of the time what we do is we use keyboard only. We don't like to use mouse as such or the keypad as such. Yeah. The third point is, making a website accessible is difficult and expensive. Why I said this is a myth is, because there are few things that we just miss and we doesn't follow, and that's why at the end when we are done with our project and then client asks for accessibility, and or maybe after the completion of the project when we think about accessibility, there are lots and lots of bugs that comes to us, right? So I understand sometimes it's difficult, but there are a lot of things that we could have done earlier also as a developer. The fourth is, it's code that needs to be accessible. How many of you agree with this line that, you know, through coding only or through code we can make our website accessible? So why I said this is a myth is because sometimes it's design, the design in a way, design is in a way that even if you want to, if even if you want to do, make it accessible through code, we can't. I have a few examples. So let's take an example of a form. Okay, we have a form. It doesn't have any label. We are using placeholder. Now, user have no vision or he has some disability. He is using screen reader. What happens is when the focus goes onto that input box, the placeholder disappears, right? Whenever he clicks into. So now, let's say he hasn't input the correct information or he just missed two, and he goes back to that form, it won't read anything, right? That's why labels are important. In this case, usually, even if we don't talk about Drupal, usually what web developers do is they don't put label with the form, right? Or otherwise, what they do is they put display and property, which shouldn't be the case. Because even if label is there and you are applying display none property, it won't read it. So these are the things that we are missing. It's not difficult, it's not expensive, it's something that we already know, but we don't do it. So that's why I said these are the few myths about accessibility, and we have made accessibility such a big deal that we don't understand that there are a few things that we would have done earlier also, like in the beginning of the project. Now these are web content accessibility guidelines levels that they have provided. So they have created a standard guidelines and they have divided it into three levels. Level A is a very basic level that if as a website developer you are using proper structural elements or a few attributes that you already know about it, we could attain level A very easily. In level AA is bit difficult or a bit above level A. So I think videos, audios, captchas, that comes in level AA. In level AAA is like the highest level, and it is difficult and it's for complex structures. But usually, if we just follow basic accessibility guidelines regarding level A and a few of level AA, we can attain 75% of accessibility on a website very easily. So these are the principles: perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust. Perceivable means that your website should be perceivable by each and every user. We can't say that why would a blind user or why would a user with no vision will come to a website. As a developer, as a client, even if you own a website, you can't say this. It's good for you if a large spectrum of users are coming to your website. So it should be perceivable by everyone. What I meant is, let's just simply take an example. We have an image on a website, and due to some reasons, maybe due to low internet connectivity, it's not loading it. So we should have an alternative text for it, so that user can see actually what, if he is missing, if a user is missing anything, at least he or she should know what he is missing actually, right? Then operable, what I meant is, like I gave the example of a Bluetooth mouse that just suddenly stopped working. It should be operable by keyboard also. I should be able to access it, right? Third is understandable. Let's say my website is perceivable and operable both, but is it understandable? So there are few sliders that I've seen on some websites. What happens is their transition time is so quick that I can't even read the content of one slide and just goes up. So it should be easily understandable. User should have enough time to read the content on a website. Fourth is robust. What I meant by robust is it shouldn't just work on a single browser or a particular version of a browser, because you never know what user is using actually. So it should be usable on all the versions and all the browsers. So now this topic, Asmita will be delivering this.
So project. We all are aware about project life cycle. We all are following certain life cycle in our daily life while developing any site. So what are the way or overview of any project phases? Like if I consider four phases, like planning, then second would be like designing a requirement analysis and then design to be heard, then requirement analysis and research around it, and finally what we do, maintenance and what deploy. So accessibility is something which we should always consider in every phase of our project life cycle. The reason I'm saying is that we get to know in each of the phase. So first thing which we need to do in case of planning is that we need to convince our stakeholders or a client regarding why accessibility is important to for any web developer. So explaining them about the wide end users required, so making this site accessible for all of us, because if we consider about 8 to 10% of population is considered to be disabled. So from business perspective, if we target at a large audience, then it will be beneficial not just for it would be definitely greatly it will contribute to the market share and even from business perspective. So these things we need to convey to client, that why a particular site should be accessible, and what kind of disabilities people are having because of which they are not able to access their access website. Then another thing while planning is that developers should be made aware about web accessibility right from planning, designing, and even testing. So we should have a good team which is aware about accessibility. Research around the country modules which can overcome those drawbacks or issues. So these things can be considered while requirement analysis. Then most important thing while requirement analysis is our target audience. So and the project scope should be considered, like what kind of compliance level the project is going to have. So these things can be considered in requirement analysis. Then from technical perspective, we can think about like what accessibility tools would be required depending on our project scope. So research around those accessibility tools and all those things should be done. Then most important phase that comes is design phase. So accessibility is all about designing and how we present a site and which has good UX. So I would like to mention few examples like which will definitely improve the design of your site. Like many a times we use tables for representing content, but tables are definitely accessible by screen readers, but it unnecessarily reads certain things which are not required. Like if we are having a large table of about 4 to 5 columns or rows, so it unnecessarily reads that it reads about the columns and describes those. So instead of going for table, if we can manage that data in kind of paragraphs or bullets, that would be preferable. So this is one of the things which we should consider while in design phase. Then other things, unnecessary textual images are used in many of the sites. So in textual images, definitely if they are not displayed, alternative text describes about the accessibility, but from user perspective, textual images should be avoided, because what is the purpose of that textual image? If we are trying to describe the content which is above it or below it, so instead of such textual images, we should go for headers or a proper HTML structure, so that accessibility can be implemented for better purpose. And from other thing which can be part of design phase is definitely color contrast, or we should consider the people who have color disabilities. Like contrast colors should be used in case of a site, so that it is more accessible and even presentable for good user experience, not just for disabled people. And accessibility is not about just for disabled people, but also for the people who are illiterate, because screen readers definitely help them to understand the site and get an overview about the site. So accessibility, the next phase. And yes, of course the last phase was about quality assurance. So our testers should have enough knowledge about the how exactly the accessibility works and that's and how to use proper structural elements. So structure in case of how to use proper structural elements. So this is all about semantic HTML. So how do we have a proper semantic HTML? So if we have a proper structure in our website, then that site becomes accessible. So proper structure, I mean to say, using proper semantics in while implementing the site, like using header tags or header, footer, nav, then aside or any other tags which are included in HTML 5 should be part of our website structure. Instead of using divs or any other elements which are ideally not meant for that. So if we consider one example regarding div versus a button. So we all might think that even div can be themed like a button, and using JavaScript or CSS we can add that behavior as well. But the thing which actually a button tag would we should ideally prefer button tag versus div. The reason is that default theming comes with the button, then most important thing is the buttons are accessible, and divs you have to make it accessible using aria labels and all those things. So this is something which is time taking for developers as well, and unnecessary. I feel these things are unnecessary. Then if we compare, the similar thing is with links and buttons. So even links are themed as a button, but the link is not meant for it. So basically, if we don't want to face any accessibility issues in our site, then proper semantics should be followed. Then form and a form label. So form, so in any form, how does accessibility or screen readers read a form? So fields are something which we have in our form. So fields are not read, the label along with it is being read. So if we are if we hide such labels from the form, then it becomes our responsibility to make it accessible. Right, so instead of using display none or hiding it, we can use a visually hidden class instead of that.
So in this also HTML 5 was not used in Drupal 7. In Drupal 8 we have started using HTML 5. So if you see in Drupal 7, in default header or footer, it has a div with a class of header footer, and if you want to make it accessible, you have to add aria label and aria landmark group. But now what happens is in Drupal 8 we use header tag and footer tag, so it by default reads to have, so header tag is it reads header tag as banner and footer tag as footer. So we have different HTML 5 section elements that can be easily readable by the machine reader. So you don't have to add extra aria labels. Then headings, why should we use headings in our website is because you can directly access all the headings through the screen reader. I'll show you how to directly access the headings through screen reader. Now coming to link and button, why shouldn't we think link as button is when screen reader reads link, it says link. What link is supposed to mean is that it will redirect you to somewhere. What the button is supposed to mean is it's going to perform an action. They both are completely different. So even if you are giving a link as a button, it's you are going to confuse your audience. And coming to form level, I've already told like using visually hidden or anything else you can do, but you should not just hide it or remove it from a markup because it's really important. You should read it. So let's see how HTML 5 section elements, how screen reader reads it.
Shift F42, WR, and on the desktop,
MacBook. Now I'll show you how it shows you directly all the headings that are present on our page.
How this helps is if you go to manage display part of a content, for each label you have three options, above inline and four options, above inline, visibility, hidden and hidden. Above and inline are I think self-explanatory. Hidden is it will be completely hidden from the page, it will not be read by screen readers and people won't be able to see that.
But as per my understanding, if you do visibility hidden, it will take some space.
Yes. Just one pixel. Yeah. Just one pixel.
Takes space.
Yes.
And for null, it will not take space.
Yes, that's right. So it takes one pixel, so naked eyes cannot see that, but it will be.
Deepak, his point is about visibility hidden property. So visually hidden doesn't apply visibility hidden property.
Okay.
Instead, it applies this part, the CSS.
Okay.
Basically, visually hidden is a class, and whatever you are asking is a property. And one more thing, if you see, it has position absolute, so it's not going to take any space. If it's inside any element, that particular element's height of it won't be calculated for its parent. Absolute position just make that particular content, that particular element out of the DOM layer. Visual. Is it clear to you?
Yes.
So coming back to web accessibility tools and plugins. So coming back to web accessibility tools, these tools and plugins help you to access your website in an accessible manner for better user experience. So Wave tool is a Chrome extension which can be added to Chrome or Firefox. So basically this Wave tool, what it does is it evaluates your site and generates a report regarding what kind of errors your website is having or which parts of the site are not accessible, and on basically it injects icons and instructions on your site. So if you see, these are the three options which are provided by Webull, that is style, snow styles, and contrast. So style tags, when style tag is selected, it shows all the errors or elements which are accessible with the styling. And if we use no styles, then it removes the styling or CSS from your site and shows. So basically, these are other three configurations. So sometimes we require no styles because we want to just see the what we say structure of our site and what kind of things are not accessible or these things. So Webull really facilitates developers as well as testers to identify which things should be accessed and which are ideally hidden from end user and those things. In screen readers, we have three screen readers, that is VoiceOver, NVIDIA, and Rust. Then VoiceOver is something which is used for Mac, used by Mac, that is Mac operating system, Windows, Mac OS, and NVIDIA tool is mostly used on Windows operating system. Similarly, LE machine, so LE, or we can say automated tool, it is basically a command line tool which helps you to find the accessibility errors from your site. So I would like to give a demo regarding LE automation. So you can install it just by using npm, that is Node.js, npm install LE, and you just need to pass the URL of your site where you want to run the accessibility, and it will display you the results, errors on your site. So we have run one of them. We have run this LE tool on google.com, and it is highlighting that ARIA attribute. So errors are being highlighted, and the cases or results which are being passed are displayed at the end. And I would like to mention few commands related. So LE is that LE, and you can pass LE then URL of your site, and if you give some file name, it generates the reports and saves it in that file. Then web developers Chrome extension is another very useful extension. So this extension provides many facilities like disabling images, then displaying alt attributes, and hiding images. So with these plugins, you can hide all the images of your site and see how your site would appear if the images are not loaded. So for better user experience, so you can improve on that by using such extensions. Color accessibility. So color accessibility is something which we should give the most priority, because colors are something which give a more visual effect to anyone. So I prefer mostly colorable tool and color save tool. So reason behind I use colorable tool is that it provides it calculates the accessibility of your color accessibility automatically by adjusting the saturated, then brightness or hue levels, and color accessibility tells you about the focus, as you can see in this example, on using screen readers tab and all those things. It shows that which elements are being accessed, and by default certain theming comes with the focus state contrast. And Color Oracle is another automated tool which can be used to identify the color accessibility of our site. Then how to test. So Nikita has already given the demo regarding how to access your site using command tabs. So these are basically the keys which are used to access your site. So on Mac, if I consider command F5 is used to start the voiceover, and then using tab tab we can access our entire site. And if we want to access the site line by line, then control option and direction keys can be used. Similarly, we can access our site in forward as well as backward direction using shift tab. So these are few basic controls which are which help you to navigate your site. So have made an accessible design. I have developed it also. But what if the content editor who is going to add the content is not adding content as per the accessibility? So I have to teach them also that, you know, now from now on, if you are going to add this particular tag, you know, use these attributes also. Because once the development is done, we are so happy that now website is accessible. But once the content is entered into that website, again it loses some accessibility percentage. So my focus is more on what we can do. It's more about the ethics and not about if client is asking for it or if it should do it for increasing our business. It's more regarding to related to ethics only. So accessibility checklist, it should be accessible by keyboard. Screen reader should be able to read it. If I'm pressing tab key, if focus is going over any element, it should have that focus outline. I should know where I am actually, right? The reading order should be proper. The non-context content should be accessible to the user. Now I'll elaborate it more in tips and tricks. So let's take an example of image. Like I said, if image is not loading properly on a website, it should have an alternative text. But there are few images which we just use as a decorative image and it doesn't really play any role. It doesn't pass any information to the user. In that case, you should literally just leave that alternative text, alternative attribute blank, because otherwise it's going to confuse our audience. So if it's not really telling anything, let's just keep it blank so that it doesn't confuse audience. The second thing was reading order. I've seen so many designs where we have a particular block, we want it on the top for desktop, and in the mobile we want to keep it in the bottom. What we do in that case? Usually first we try to fix it by CSS, position absolute, and then we keep it in the bottom only. But we almost screen readers read according to the elements that are present in the order in DOM, right? So if you see, element is in the top, in the DOM, but by positioning absolute, we have kept it in the bottom. So it's not going to read it properly and we are confusing our audience, right? Other thing that we do is, what we'll do, we'll have two blocks, one on the top, one on the bottom, and we'll play with display and property. Again, it's not good because it's adding load to your website. In this case, what you should do, you should look for other options. So I faced the same problem. What I did, I used PHP library and I detected if it's a mobile or desktop and I placed that block accordingly. So in my DOM, it was present there in the logical order only. So according to the accessibility, screen reader was reading it properly. So this was related to the elements to be present in DOM in the logical order. Now, ARIA and landmark rules. Asmita,
so anyone can tell you what are ARIA labels or ARIA landmark rules? Anyone has any idea about ARIA?
It displays the class name, ARIA label.
Yes, but what is basic class name? It doesn't display class name. Basically, ARIA labels, I'll come to ARIA labels later. So if we consider ARIA landmark rules, so ARIA landmark rules is something which is being added by ARIA is a concept which is being added by W3C in their specification, and the simplest way to achieve ARIA features in your site is ARIA landmark rules. So basically, ARIA landmark rules are rules which are, if we consider a content on any page, then it is divided into all these sections. So these rules identify or justify what the content is about. So if we consider banner, main, search, navigation, all these are kind of rules which ARIA landmark it specifies. So while accessing your site using screen readers, it helps you to identify in what section you are. So basically, if we consider an example regarding menu or bar, it will be you are in main navigation or you are in footer. All these things are included in the rule. So that is why I was stressing on proper structural element, because all these things come hand in hand when we follow proper structure. So you might be thinking about if we have two search boxes or two forms in ARIA labels come into play. So ARIA labels distinguishes between, so we have to provide ARIA labels in that case if we have two forms or two search searches on same page. So ARIA label distinguishes between those two landmark words. So I would like
there is a question.
I'm not able to understand this ARIA language. Where can you see in web pages?
It's
actually HTML attribute. HTML attribute.
Where can you see?
Yeah, they will show.
The black bread, I'll ask.
Since it's a component, that's it's an element that's already in the DOM, using jQuery, you can put your focus there. The other thing that you can do is, for all the errors, you can show all the errors on the top of the form. So if I'm missing the first name, you show first name is missing, my focus will go there. If I input my first name, then other again I'm trying to submit it, and if there is another input that's required and I missed to put the value, it will be shown on the top. Now in these things, this is the main part where designer also plays their role. So I have to go to the designer. See, earlier you said that if I forgot to enter any value that's required, you were showing a red border inside that input box, but it wasn't reading anything. So people who are visually fine, they can see it. But if there are people who just use screen readers, they won't get to know that there's something that they are missing out, and they won't be able to submit the form. So this is how accessibility plays its role, and we all have to play our role to make our website accessible. So we have to go to the designer again to please change the design a little bit. Can we show our errors in inline form or on the top so that user can hear it? So these are the things, these are the few things that if we would have kept in mind in the starting, we would have told our designers then and there, you know, this is not accessible, user are not going to hear it, so can you please change it? So during the requirement or during the phase where we see the designs and we tell designer if it's feasible or not, we should talk about accessibility a little bit, right? So now we'll talk about how SEO and accessibility go together. I mean, I understand it's about ethics, as a good developer we should do it, but at the end it's business, and SEO is very, very important for our websites, right? So if accessibility and SEO goes together, then I think we'll be more able to focus on this particular topic, right?
So if you see, accessible design enhances your user experience. So from end user perspective, if your site is having some very fancy design, but if it is not accessible to anyone, then such sites are doesn't have that great experience. Even Google has said in their statement that sites which have good user experience are more accessible. So in this way, good user experience site contributes to SEO. Then second thing which I would like to mention is title tags help screen readers and searches. So title tag is something which screen reader reads it for the very first, is the very first thing which screen readers read is the title tag. And whenever you search anything on Google, so basically the search engine uses some algorithm and algorithm behind it, and it searches for all the titles from other sites. So in this way, the title is important for SEO search. Then good header structure establishes content hierarchy. So good header structure that even Nikita has mentioned before, that H1 to H6 are the header tags which are commonly implemented in a site. So header tags are something which should be implemented in any of the sites while using for if we want to make our site better accessible. So header tags are also helps in or facilitates in Google search, and Google search, or we can say SEO related things. So in this way, even a type headers contribute, or proper structure contributes to SEO. Then comes the sitemap. So sitemap, everyone must be aware, if we want to navigate any of the sites, sitemaps helps in navigating our site. So sitemaps are something which SEO has we can say SEO commonly focuses on such things if we have site maps in our site. So all these things are related to SEO and how they go together.
For the good header structure, I have a very small example. So I just searched 10 steps to buying a house, and the steps that it's showing me, if you will go to this particular website, I got to know that all the steps that they are showing there, these are actually heading tags. So heading tags contribute a lot for our SEO as well as for accessibility. So all these steps that are coming there, it's actually all the heading text that are there on that particular page of that website. So heading text play a very, very important role for SEO plus accessibility. So now I'm going to talk about what are the accessibility features that Drupal 8 provides. So the first is, in Drupal 8 we have HTML5. We have got few new section elements by HTML5 that are footer, header, that we should use so that we can avoid using ARIA attributes. The second is ARIA. So have you guys observed that there are few blocks or in the menu you can see there are ARIA attributes that are added by Drupal core itself. We don't add it by ourselves. Have you seen it? Let me give you a very, very simple example of the menu. We are using menu in Drupal since very long time. Menu is the very basic element or basic block that we use. Let's take example of DCP 19 site. So this is my menu. It has ARIA labeled by, and in this it has given the idea of this H2 tag. So what will happen is when I'll focus on it, it will be main navigation menu. So Drupal is playing it very smart. What it did, it added a H2 tag. It placed visually hidden class so that it's not visible to us. And what it's doing is in the nav, it gave the idea of this H2 tag to the nav using ARIA labeled by attribute. So it will read it as main navigation menu and you will get to know you are on main navigation menu. Where this main navigation is coming from, it's the title of the menu that we entered when we created that menu. So Drupal is playing it really smart, and there are many other ARIA attributes that Drupal core has started putting into our website and our templates. Regarding the alternative text, so in Drupal 8, if you are using image field, you can make that alternative text required. So it's compulsory for you to add the alternative text. So this is really a good feature. Now you don't have to check individually that, you know, if there is alternative text or not. You don't have to go to content editor. It will show the error then and there that it's a required field and you have to enter it. Now, then accessible inline form errors. It is actually in Drupal core, but it's not enabled by default. So we can use it to make our forms accessible. It will allow us. You can even integrate it with web forms. So what it will, it will allow us to add inline form errors so that screen reader will read all the errors instead of having those HTML5 validation. And we can even change the text of the errors. We can have it as per our requirement. Hide content properly. I'll show you a very simple example. We all have seen this screen many times. Manage fields, right? So in manage display, what we do is in the label, we can place it above, we can place it in inline, we can hide it, we can visually hide it. When we'll do hidden, what it will do, it will apply display null property. If you are using visually hidden, it will apply visually hidden class to it, and I have already shown you the CSS. What it will do is it will make it position absolute, it will reduce its height and width to 1 pixel. So the content will be there, but it won't be visible to us, but screen readers can read it. So these are the very features that we usually avoid, but Drupal is doing it to make our websites accessible. Contributed modules that we can use to extend accessibility in Drupal. I personally used only external links module. I did because it depends on the requirement project to project. That's why we are not even giving demo for it, because it completely depends what kind of website we are building, what kind of elements we are using, and accessibility is really not something that I or someone can teach you. It completely depends. When you Google about it, you'll get to know so many hacks, and you'll use that particular hack that is good for your website, that is good for that particular structure that you are using. So these are the few modules that we can use. One is automatic alternative text. What it does is, in case if you forgot to add So like I told you, using the screen reader, it will give me the list of all the roles that are present in my page. So if I use this module, what it will do, the next time if I'm creating any custom block or if I'm placing any block, be it menu block or anything, it will place landmark role to that block so that screen reader can read it, and people who can't see it or they have visual disability, they can listen to it. Third is external links. So there are so many external links on our website, but when screen reader reads it, it reads only that it's a link. But user should get to know that they are going to redirect it to some other website. It's not that particular website. We are not going to redirect it to an internal page, but it's going to be somewhere else. And then text resize. Text resize module provides two buttons, one is plus and minus. So user, as per their disability or as per their visual disability, they can increase or decrease the font size of the content that is on our page, and they can read it. Apart from that, I have a very good example of how Drupal provides accessibility. So when we use tab, what it does is it reads the interactive elements only. By interactive elements, I mean links, buttons. These are the interactive elements that we can read through tab button. Otherwise, we have to go line by line so that it can read it properly. Now I have four links. Read mode. That's how screen readers read links. It will read the text of the anchor tag. So in this case, if I can't see it, I'm accessing it through a screen reader. What will it read? My focus went on this. Next, it will go in the next block according to the logical order. Let's say my logical order is 1, 2, 3, 4. It will read link, read more, link, read more. Right? How would I get to know what I'm reading? What will we do in this case? How many of us are Drupal developers here? How many of you think it is going to read link, read more? Link, read more. I'm telling you, Drupal plays it really, really smart. Let me show you how it reads.
Can I just make it accessible? Just changing the design a little bit
Should I talk to the designer? So for designer, it's also a plus point. I just wish there were a few designers in this session, so they would have got a little idea about how they can make their design accessible. We can only make it accessible through coding. It's designer's job to make design accessible so that we can make it accessible through code, right? Second is for developer. You should use proper semantic structure elements. Stop using ARIA attributes with no purpose. You know, if it's ARIA was actually used to make your website accessible, but what we are doing is we are using it as a shortcut. We'll, for the header, what we'll do, we'll use div tag ARIA label header. Otherwise, what would we would have done is we would have used header tag only. So we should read HTML5 more now because it's Drupal, in Drupal 8, it's HTML5. Other things for developers is go through designs properly, use proper structural elements. Don't use CSS just to place an element here and there on the visual layer. It should be logically correct also, otherwise it's not going to read it properly. Third thing is for content editor. If there is a content editor on a project that is supposed to be accessible, it's their job also to come to the developer that I know that you have developed it and you have made it accessible, but now I'm going to add this anchor tag. Can I just add it like this, or are there any attributes, or is there any guideline that I need to follow? And you should also prepare a guideline for the content editor. Otherwise, even if you have done a great job, it's going to get ruined at the end. So these are the takeaways for designer, developer, and content editor. Best, I think, tester will do. Find more enemies. Are there any questions?
What about sitemaps, accessibility?
Actually, I read it somewhere that there are few people that who have visual disability. They use sitemaps to read the websites. So if you have site, although we use sitemap for SEO purpose only, for crawlers we use it, right? But it is good for accessibility also because few people, few users actually use it to navigate through your site. I don't have an idea how they use it,
yeah,
but they use sitemap.
I think
sitemap
might have the option that if you use the website, it might provide you a
sitemap is something that the SEO would use, but if you're going to use the HTML sitemap, that's something that can be made accessible and end users or challenged people can probably use. XML sitemap shayad nahi padega. There are two kinds of sitemap. One is XML, which is just for SEO. Another one is an HTML sitemap, which is something that's visible to end users.
Any other questions?
What about mobile app related UI, UX? Mobile app related UX, in that case, can we apply this kind of thing?
Yeah, we can use these same things for the mobile. So for
mobile
this same website, if you're doing in mobile or completely different mobile
application? Mobile app I'm talking about. Like in, suppose we are using some native application, mobile application.
I have worked on websites.
This is more related to web accessibility,
more, yeah.
But I think similar guidelines will be available for app accessibility as well. You might want to read that.
No, there are no other guidelines for
if
native apps for websites.
Web
there are standard guidelines only. Maybe the hacks are different, or maybe the what you should use. Those things might be different, but guidelines are standard for.
If you are using the web view,
yeah,
in the mobile, the same HTML, CSS, web view.
So what Wave tool tells us is if there are few alternative tags that you have missed, alternative attributes that you have missed, otherwise if there are few structural elements that you have missed or you are not using it properly, if there are broken links or not. So if you are doing the same website in mobile also, the errors are going to be same only. There are no other, it doesn't really take in like, it's not affected by the width of the device. It's missed, I mean, it's not there, so you have
to. It will work in mobile as well. Just like in web, if you are calling the web view in the mobile.
Wave 2, you are asking about
wave
view. Web
view.
Web view. Web view is native.
The web view, when we are creating any mobile app, so we create the RPK file, and that we call that URL.
For web view, everything would be the same.
Yeah.
In
and
case of a native app on a screen, things would probably vary.
And to test that on the different devices, it's like each and every device has their own accessibility.
Mostly of listening and all these things which will be helpful in mobile devices, modern desktop.
Yeah.
Because many people are using now mobiles. Everything if they are listening, that is from the mobile.
Yeah, that's true, but each and every mobile device is based on the operating system. They have their own accessibility features they have inbuilt in that operating system. So by enabling that, we can check whether the app or the web page which we are opening on the browser is accessible or not. So it is not going to be altogether a different thing if you are testing any application using the accessibility feature of any mobile, and so it would not be any difference between app versus application versus website. So it would remain the same. There could be the difference between the gesture to know that whether the accessibility working with the gesture is working properly.
Thank you guys.